Welcome back to Supremely Black Podcast. This is your co-host D Rose, man. We got the crew back, as you can see. For the visual listeners, the audio listeners, you would actually hear that as well. So how's everything going with y'all today, fella?
Everything cool. Can't complain. Had a good holiday not too long ago. You was just in town, just dropped y'all off at the airport not too long ago, and here we are recording an episode. So everything been great, can't complain, staying busy. I think the last I talked to y'all, the last I talked to the crew, the comedy special was just at the Jackson, Mississippi Film Festival. But we did the New Orleans Second Line Film Festival, got selected and was a semi-finalist there. So we moving and grooving. We moving and grooving with that comedy special, and we trying to get it streaming everywhere, get it processed and get it going. But everything's been great. Just staying busy with these girls, staying busy, busy, busy.
The next spot's supposed to be New Orleans, ain't it? That you gonna have it at?
Yeah, we already did New Orleans. New Orleans was selected and was a semi-finalist in New Orleans. So they done,
okay.
They put it on their website for people to go watch it and everything.
Okay, bet. That's what's up. Congratulations.
Salute, my brother. Salute. That's big. I know I never got the chance to tell you, but I listened to it. I got it in my playlist on my music and everything. So yeah, that jump funny, you know.
I appreciate it, man.
Yeah, so I'll be listening to that. And to be honest, you and TK Kirkland, the only two comedians that I got they comedy special on in my music playlist and everything. So when I be hitting shuffle and it and you be surprised when you hear it come through, and then all you can do is laugh once you hear the joke and let it ride. Yeah. So yeah.
You got me in there mixed in with a legend right there, boy.
Yeah. Definitely. So I'll be hearing slow jams or hearing some rap. Then all of a sudden I hear your voice come in. I'll be cracking up.
Yeah, man. That's good stuff, though. What's been going on with you, though, Spirit?
Shit, I'm making it day by day. Everything good over here, though. I can't complain, to be honest. So, just grinding and just trying to, I don't want to say implement, but trying to step into some things that I should have been stepping into for a minute. And so, that's about it. But everything's good. Life is good. Kids are good. So I can't complain. And just grinding, and that's all I'm doing. So
for sure. Well, yeah, man. As Flaker stated, man, it's been a solid week. I actually got to get home. I know a lot of people had asked me, because they hear it from the short episodes that I may drop, is who is CeCe? December 3rd of 2021, CeCe is actually my mother. So we had lost her unexpectedly. So I went to the city and celebrated with the fam and, you know, just spread a lot of love. So that's just what that was. Everything has been good. Like I could say, over a year, we haven't lost any other important pieces to the puzzle. So you just have to look at that and just be blessed that, you know, you could look around. And of course, you're missing a key part. But another blessing is, you know, a lot of families get hit back to back to back. And I could just say that I'm thankful that we didn't have to experience that, because, you know, what that was tough enough. But it was good to see, you know, family, classmates, for the people that reached out. I couldn't text everybody back, but it's love. I definitely appreciate it. But, you know, we gonna keep working, man, and keep pushing. So, you know, it's always long live CeCe. So that's what that means for the people that have asked. But as we transition into it, man, it's the hot topic out here on the streets. Everybody know what's going on, man. Coach Prime is sellout. That's what they saying. You know what I'm saying? It's kind of crazy. That's what the streets say, right? You feel me? So it's man, what's y'all thoughts? It's so many ways, so many angles. We're gonna have to touch bases on this a few times, man. But I think the sellout one is being used the most. Like, Spears, what's your thoughts, man? Because you actually played football at a couple HBCUs, if I'm not mistaken. So what's your thoughts on just people calling him a sellout, since you've actually experienced, and you would have more knowledge of, you know, what would it have been like to play for a Coach Prime? So what's your thoughts on that?
My thoughts honestly is I don't know how you could call this man a sellout. I mean, he did what he came to do. I understand, and I'm privy to some things that maybe everybody may not be privy to. So some of the things that he was dealing with in the background that he didn't expose or that he didn't scream and shout to the world or to the masses to know and stuff. So when you're doing a lot of the things that he did, there's only so much you could take. And to a point, because I've been reading and hearing what people are saying, and they're saying, oh, it was about Prime, it was about his ego and stuff. To a point, yes, because who in this world isn't that way? Who in this world is not doing something for themselves? Like, I don't know nobody who does something that does not have a benefit to themselves. Even if you are a person who gives away most of your income to charity, you giving away and helping others makes you feel good inside. So you're doing that for yourself. So therefore, I don't understand when people was like, oh, he's selfish, he a sellout and all this other stuff. Now, I do get, or this is one thing I do want to say, like, I do understand that he did the decision that optically doesn't look right, but it's the only decision that he could have made, because he did the decision only he could have made, because he couldn't leave those kids to go to another HBCU. If he would have went to another HBCU, then it would have been he abandoned those kids. So by him going to a D1 school, he did what only he could do, because Jackson State has history. Jackson State is has a history, but it's not like Jackson State is one of them big dogs in the HBCU world. If he was at a Hampton, if he started at a North Carolina A&T, a Alabama A&M, even a Tennessee State, a school of that nature, and then he did what he did, things may be a little bit different. But Jackson State was irrelevant at the time that Deion came in, and then he brought them back to relevance. I mean, again, Walter Payton went there and everything, so we can't act like Jackson State was never anything in you know, the world of HBCUs, even academically or sports-wise, because they have history. But again, they was dead. They was nothing. Everything that he provided there, and then the stuff that he had to go to, when you're taking some of your own revenue from your job to provide things for the children, for the kids, how dare you tell me that it's about me and I'm only doing this for me, when my paycheck that makes less than he's ever made in his adult life, because he's not hurting for money, he's not longing for money. My paycheck that I make, I'm actually giving it back to the school to finish providing facilities and certain things for these kids, and you telling me that, oh, I'm selfish now because I decided to do something that was better for me? Nah, to me, that's bogus.
Yeah, I think the sellout word is being used a little too much. You know, people tend to throw that word around a lot because you might not agree with the decision that they made. And the only thing I can get when I ask these people, how did he sell out? Man, he leaving them kids behind. He made promises to them kids. Okay, but he ain't the first coach to ever do this. A lot of coaches go to a school and they be there a year or two and have all these kids come play at that school and then leave. Now, one, he didn't make no promise. He told y'all from Jump Street, it ain't about the money, and I'd be foolish not to entertain a Power 5 school if they gave me an offer. We have to go back and remember that he first started off trying to get the Florida State job. That's how he first started off after he left the high school, after he left with IMG or whatever, wherever he was at. And where was he at? I can't remember what the high school he was at.
I think he had his own school, but it was another school that was close to Dallas that they were at. I forgot the name. It's like a Christian school, though.
Yeah, he had his own school, and then he was coaching
at folded.
Yeah, that folded, and then he was coaching at Trinity something. I forgot the name of it.
It's a Christian school.
not Euless Trinity, another Trinity school that was a private school in the Christian school or whatever, and that's where he was
coaching.
Yeah.
Okay, gotcha. So he left when he was at that school. He was up that where they was trying to get him the Florida State job, and that didn't work out. So it was already in our mind that he was already trying to go to a Power Five school anyway. He went to Jackson State. You know, he probably, be honest with you, when you coach for them private schools, they pay you big money for high school. High school, private Christian schools pay you money.
Well, hold up, time out. When he was coaching high school, he was still getting an NFL network check because he was right. still doing that. It was once he started coaching college that he stopped doing TV.
Exactly.
So he was still getting $1 million or more a year from his NFL check that he was doing while he was coaching high school.
So I don't understand how everybody keep coming about talking about just because somebody came with a bigger bag as why he leaving, and he made promises to these kids. I mean, at the end of the day, he did everything he was supposed to do at Jack State, everything he said he was going to do. You got to remember, when it rained, they couldn't even practice. This man went and got them two practice facilities. Two of them. This man brought sellout crowds back. This man got them new uniforms, new locker rooms, name on the back of the jersey, cleats, whatever they asked for, they got. He did more of them 3 years that people has been at HBCUs for 20 years could not do. And you call them bounces.
And he did that with the resource of his name and who he is.
Right.
So he put his name on the line for them.
Which he didn't have to do. He didn't have to do none of that. He didn't have to leave his ranch. He didn't have to leave his high school job. He didn't have to leave NFL Network. He didn't have to do none of that. But his heart is in coaching and turning kids around. The thing is, while I'm here, I'm going to do the best I can for HBCUs, got y'all TV contracts, got college. Y'all, man, we went from ESPN3, ESPN2, to being on College Game Day. I remember they was only coming on, you can only catch an HBCU game at one point in time. I forgot the name of the network, but it was like a black network, it was a circle network or something, like a black-owned network. Only place that was showing HBCU football games. And then that when the Classic come on at Thanksgiving, they'll show that. And then the SWAC Championship, they'll show that. But that wasn't consistent with ESPN at all. Sometimes SWAC Championship be on ESPN, sometimes it won't be. Next year to be on there, next year it won't be on there. Now you got everybody signed with a contract where it's going to be consistently on TV. And you call this man a sellout, a coon, and everything else because he wanted to leave. Because what? Because he didn't retire there? Somebody gave an example that I thought about. Everybody know the famous head coach, Eddie Robson. Grant. This man was the most winningest coach in college football ever. He did. He had opportunities to leave Grambling, go to other places, never left. He don't even really get the recognition he deserved. They hardly even mention Eddie Robson unless the HBCU games is on. And he was at one point in time, he was the winningest coach in college football ever. Folks don't be appreciating stuff while it's there, if you ask me, in my opinion. I don't think a lot of folks really shout to the mountaintop and things like that unless you up and just leave and then all of a sudden everybody mad. He can't save everybody. He's doing the best he can.
That's my thoughts in regards to it. I would not consider him a sellout. Now, I will say that, I mean, I've heard some legit points in regards to, okay, he sold it upon culture and things like that. But you got to think, they got like a 10-year contract now with HBCU so that they would be covered on ESPN2, 3. Those are huge things, like, you know what I'm saying, College Game Day. So really, he's laid out the blueprint. He's recorded majority of his content. So you really can't say that he didn't give back the game to show you exactly what it is. Now, people aren't going to have the prime time effect, but we just have to acknowledge that as a culture is because to Flake point, I mean, you could sit there and just be dormant and yeah, you're making your impact, but how much bigger could he get besides, honestly, he just starts completely dominating the HBCUs and then they're like, well, he's only getting all the talent because of who he is. And then you're looking at it like Alabama, then you're looking at it like Dabo Swinney and Clemson and any other major powerhouse program is like, how do you even out the competition? Is because then they're going to start finding fault in his celebrity is the only reason why he's actually coaching. And is he really a good coach? And then when you think about somebody that's competitive like him, and he spoke about it several times, you only can hear for so long that you aren't the coach that everybody wants to come play for. Eventually, he's going to have to take his talents to greater areas and have a greater reach. And he's not robbing the HBCUs are 5- and 4-star recruits, because at the end of the day, I mean, he put the spotlight on it. So it's really upon other coaches to be able to have a pitch like him. So I get what they're saying. That's a legit thing. It's like, I thought it was about establishing the HBCUs to a powerhouse. Okay, cool. So what is Jackson State, what is the state of Mississippi doing to actually be able to fund him, provide him with the resources? He pretty much did all of that on his own without any support besides the Jackson State alum, well, not even the Jackson State alumni, the fans that are always going to support, because we know they pack out the house. They've always been known to travel well and do things like that. But you can't expect for this man to go against the state, the city, and other Power Fives with limited resources. Yeah, he could make it big, but maybe they've hit, maybe he felt like he hit his ceiling and everybody else went on board, because really it was a lot of slick hating going on, because it was a celebrity coach that happened to be one of the greats that was attracting the talent. I don't think it was extremely supportive. You should have been getting people behind Eddie George, the other black coaches in it. It should have been an equal amount of attention, but they have to know how to do that. I'm showing you, but if you ain't me, you ain't me. And that's just what that is. Nick Saban come down, sit on the couch. He don't have to say too much. I mean, it speaks for itself. He could have made Jackson State a powerhouse like that, but then eventually they're going to say, okay, the talent isn't like that. I mean, if you're not a 4- or 5-star recruit, he flipped Travis Hunter. He's not going to be able to flip everybody. I mean, he's going to one of the most dangerous cities in the country, and he's trying to get kids to come play down there with limited resources for them to even do outside of football. It's going to be hard. I don't think he was a sellout. I think he put on, and I think people should take the baton and keep it moving instead of just saying, okay, well, what he didn't do, because who knows if he's going to actually be scheduling HBCUs to play on senior night, homecoming night, opening night. He could be putting all those schools. He may play Jackson State when he's able to correct the schedule. He may play Grambling, you know, teams out of the MAC. You don't know what his plan is, and if he's always shown love all 3 years and stuff that he didn't have to do, you don't know what his plan is. He may be paying to get more money. I'm going to give y'all $1 million or $2 million every year to come play us. But you're going to benefit off of it. What you're doing with this budget, that's on you. So we don't know his plan. I think he was solid. I don't think it was as egotistical as people trying to make it out to be. I think if he wasn't successful and he got the opportunity, then we would hear the other side of the fence having a lot to say about his celebrity is the only reason why he's getting a coaching opportunity, because he couldn't even dominate the HBCUs. Let's be honest, that's what they'd have went with. He couldn't win no way. That's just what that is to me.
Well, no matter how long he stayed, it wasn't no winning. Well, he had to damn near die there before somebody agreed with it. But anything under 5 years, wasn't nobody gonna, hell no, nah, he's gonna receive a lot of scrutiny.
Exactly.
Well, I just want to add some stuff that I know he hasn't exposed or whatever, and that I'm a little privy to, and everything that my resources have told me or whatever. So just to make people get a better understanding of it as well. One thing that we got to consider is, this is just the business of coaching. Nick Saban left LSU, went to Alabama. After a year after he won a national championship at LSU. Lincoln Riley just left Oklahoma and went to USC. It goes on and on in the coaching business. This is the state of coaching. It happens all the time. So you can't say nothing about abandoning or whatever, and then try to make a black person a sellout. That is one problem with our community. When it happens in our culture, it's, oh, you a sellout or whatever. When white people do it or other people do it, it's, oh, get your money, or oh, this is the best place for you or the best opportunity or whatever. We have to stop tearing each other down. But to add some more things that people aren't talking about and all this other stuff, where I can say, this comes from ego, but then this also comes from you just wanting to be in a better position and situation for yourself and for the kids. Let's talk about the Jackson water crisis. When you're in a place like that and you have to deal with that, and then you put that on the forefront, you go to the mayor and the governor of the state, you go to the mayor of the city and the governor of the state, you put this on the forefront to make things change, and things take time to change. It didn't change overnight, even with that being on all mass media and major media outlets. It took time for that to change. But when you're dealing with that and you are who you are, and then you see your kids being affected by this, that hurts. That makes you want to say, man, I don't know if I could deal with this too much longer. And I feel for the kids that are there. You also got to think, he's still a father. Two of his kids are there living that. Oh, his daughter went to Jackson State too.
Yeah,
right?
His daughter, yeah. Shiloh and Shadur. Yeah.
And Junior, Deion Sanders Jr. was there all the time. I don't know if he flew in and out, but he was there all the time too. So basically his family is there, but three of his kids are living that life at Jackson State and have to experience that on a daily basis. Nobody wants their children not being able to shower, not being able to brush their teeth, not being able to drink a living, successful water that's not going to damage you and tear your body up, filled with different parasites, lead, different things that are detrimental to your livelihood. So as a father, you don't want that. So then two, you as a teacher and a developer of man, you don't want your players and the students to go through that. So let's just deal with that off top. And that's not nothing that he could have controlled or anything like that. But then let's also talk about when you are taking your own money to provide, to build resources for the school, and you still getting told no, when you spending some of your own money, but you getting told no. Now let's think who Deion is. Deion's a Hall of Famer. He is with no debate. Like when you talk about debating who the best is in basketball, you can say LeBron, you can say MJ, you can say Kareem, you can name some people. When you talk about who is the best quarterback of all time in the NFL, you can say Tom, you can say Peyton, you can say Joe Montana, you could debate it. When you talk about who the best corner of all time is, there's no debate. It's Deion Sanders. No debate. He is the GOAT with no debate. Most GOATs are debatable. He's the GOAT that there is no debate about. So when you talk about telling him no, when he's even providing and taking out of his own pockets to bring stuff and you still telling him no, he gonna be like, do I really wanna go through this where I'm spending my own money to provide this and they're still telling me, no, I can't do this, or I'm still having to go to jump through hoops and hurdles to create this and to get this done for these kids and students? The next thing is, I don't know how true this is. I wasn't able to check my sources on this, but when you have people trying to embezzle money from the kids at the university, he has to deal with that. And so when you're getting told no, and then you're dealing with people trying to embezzle money and keep money from these kids and not let the school elevate to the level that it could be elevated, he's Deion, he's prime. So yes, his ego gonna say, man, I love these kids, man. I want kids to go to HBCUs, man. I want this for this. But again, he wasn't at a Howard. He wasn't at a Hampton. He wasn't at a North Carolina A&T. He wasn't at a Tennessee State. He wasn't at an Alabama State or A&M or anything like that. He wasn't there. So then therefore, he's not. There's levels in HBCUs just like there's levels at PWIs. And the level of HBCU he was at, that to dealing with the niggerdom, to dealing with the hell and everything, it's not the same. Some people have their T's crossed and their I's dotted when it comes to HBCUs, and they hold it to the highest standard and they mean everything about it. And some HBCUs still got niggas being niggas, trying to get over, trying to do this, but take from these kids. And that's just the honest truth. The other part of it is that I will say too, is why black people are upset. Because now the accountability is on them. Because now they got to see, oh, because Deion gone, are you still going to pack out that stadium like you was just because Deion was there? Are you still going to support just because he had Dolph come up there? He had Gilly the Kid. He had all these stars and entertainment people come up there to support. Are y'all still going to support? Now the responsibility is on you. Are you going to let Jackson State falter back down to what it was before he got there? Or are you going to hold the standard still high that he created it and made it to be now that he's gone? So now the responsibility is on you and not Deion no more. And so you're mad because the responsibility is falling on you. and you can't have a scapegoat. So if something falters or fails or whatever, you could say, oh, that's Deion's fault, that's him fault. Nah, it's y'all fault now. So it's the alumni fault, it's the city of Jackson, it's all of y'all. If y'all let this school falter, if it does not become what it was, the weight is on you, the blame is on you, not Deion no more. And that's a real reason why a lot of these people are mad and upset, because now the accountability falls on them and they don't want them problems. I'm done.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, because I feel like he called out the city on the water. He called out the city on the crime, which, you know, that's happening everywhere. But when you think about those pivotal things, that caused a lot of action to the government. So a lot of it, like I said, with his success, it led from things being impacted off of the football field. And we all know of how society works, and what we've seen is that when you become you're already a prominent figure and you step into a space like that, especially HBCUs, you're holding them accountable, because honestly, that's the best thing going in Mississippi over Ole Miss, any other Mississippi State, anything that was actually a big Power Five school he had and was garnering more attention, and they had more resources. So when you get to that type of thing, honestly, they're not expecting anybody to get to a point to where they're calling out the city on the water, or, hey, what's still going on with the crime? This still is going on crazy. We're generating, just from an HBCU perspective, those 3 years, I think they said like $30 million, or they haven't even accounted for what the social economic impact that it had this year. So when you get to that point, you're putting some pressure, you're pushing some buttons on people that may not have ever wanted to change the situation in Jackson State, specifically around HBCUs and the culture of it. Let's just be real. Sometimes that's just what the real underlying thing is. Like, who does this guy think he is? Just shut up and coach football. He was bigger than the program, and that's just what he ended up being. So I don't blame him for making his moves and doing what he do, because at the end of the day, he's still coaching with the same guys that he started coaching Pee Wee football with. So if he was a sellout, they would have been gone. They wouldn't have made it to Jackson State with him. Because I'm pretty sure with him having who he is, he has a lot of political people that is in his space that would love to put somebody that they want to push up through the coaching hierarchy close to him and allow them to just propel off of being one of under Deion's wing, and they would gladly take that position. He hasn't. He still has the same people that's around him. We just got to look at using that sellout just because somebody else is, you know, moving on and doing better. It's not on one man. That's the entire HBCU, from the SWAC, the MEAC, everybody. Like, it's on y'all now to, you know, keep pushing it. It's no reason it shouldn't stop. We still got the same swag. We still got the same influence. What you going to do with it? Jackson State wasn't the only school that people want to go to. You feel me? Like, that just wasn't. Jackson, Mississippi ain't that entertaining. I love my partners, you know what I'm saying, from out that way. But they would tell you, if it wasn't for HBCU and the football games, you probably really ain't just going to Jackson State playing around like that. It's like that. You know what I'm saying? Unfortunately.
Yeah. And two more points that I got to make, and I think I'm done. But unless y'all make another point, I might jump in. But one other thing I want to say is that another reason why I don't think he'll sell out is because Colorado was not his only offer. Let's not play and be dumb like that was his only offer. But he chose Colorado because Colorado has a small history of football prominence. He wants to create his own legacy. So he probably could have went to Auburn. He probably got a call from Auburn. He probably could have went to one of these big school openings or whatever, but he chose Colorado because he know there's not much history there, but he wants to create what he wants to create there and it be his own. So he wants to go through the trenches and go through the work of building a legacy similar to what Alabama, Notre Dame, LSU, Texas, Florida, and things of that nature are. He wants to go through that work. Secondly, I want to say this. He gonna bring some of them kids that are at Jackson State that he think is worthy. So Travis Hunter, if Travis Hunter wants to, is going to Colorado. Now, it's only if Travis Hunter wants to, but best believe he telling Travis Hunter, come on with me. He already said that his sons are coming with him. So he's gonna bring the players. Yeah. He's gonna bring the players that deserve to be there that show him what they are to bring to come there. Also, I just want to make this clear. He could not have, because elevation is the thing of life. He could not have left them kids though for another HBCU. Then he would have been a sellout. He couldn't go to another HBCU. So he was strapped on how he could elevate. So he did the next best thing. I got a Power Five offer from a school that's in a good conference or a decent conference. I know they're about to lose two teams, so it's going to weaken the conference a little bit, but they're still in a good conference. And I'm going to work my ass off to make this on the same playing field as a Alabama, on the same playing field as a University of LSU, a Florida, a Texas, a Oklahoma, a USC. And so that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah, it ain't like he went to a school that was out there winning. Cats won in 11 last year. You know, the Colorado hadn't been good in football since the 90s. It's been since the 90s, the last time they was even decent in football. He wouldn't have been a sellout to some people. When else?
It was
2000?
No, 22. So it was like 18, 17. They went 11 in, or they went 10 and 3 or something like that.
That must have been the only season in a long time.
It was one season, and it only happened one season, but it was just like
we ain't counting
between,
it. So they
in between 5 years ago.
Right. We ain't counting it. So they ain't been good since the 90s. So they ain't been consistently good since the 90s. Let's just say. If he went to another HBCU, he only been a sellout to some other people, because another HBCU with open arms. It would have been a whole new band situation. It would have been all on TV and everything else. How it would have been. But we all know, like, hold on, player, you just leaving that bad because the situation was bad. So you might be leaving because you turned it around, but you still not getting what you want. Let's go to another one to see if I can get what I want. That's how I would have been. That's how I would have looked at it. However, I do agree with D Rose. I do think that he will do a situation where, because he's talked about this, where these teams have Power Five schools out, maybe have not offered HBCUs to come play them, you know, and not pay them. And then when they do get offered to go to some play at certain schools, they're not as paid as much as other schools to get it done. So I do feel like that he will invite an HBCU. Not saying it's gonna happen this next season coming up, anything like it's gonna probably take a little bit of time. But I think he will invite a few HBCUs to come play them and probably offer him $3-5 million. And we're going to fly you out. We're going to feed you. We got your hotel. On top of that, we're going to pay you $2-3 million. And y'all take that back to the schools. Now, with that in mind, if he does that, he's doing more than what he could do being a head coach of Jackson State. He can do what he can for that one school if he the coach of Jackson State, but being a coach of Colorado, if I bring up TSU, if I bring up Alabama A&M, if I bring up Jackson State, just alone, I done dropped off over $1 million a piece to three different schools. And that's more he could ever have done being a head coach at Jackson State. I don't think people really look at that. I don't think people even know. Some people don't even know when they invite these smaller schools to come play them, that they getting paid millions of dollars to come play. You do that to HBCU a couple times, boy, you done dropped out. You done changed the whole dynamics of the school. And it's a whole lot of stuff to get fixed. I know one thing in Tennessee State, they can take them kids up out them hotel rooms and they give them $2-3 million because they show fix a dorm issue they got going on with that one game alone. And that'll fix a whole lot of situations for a lot of schools.
So I don't even, this isn't really circulating, but Colorado, and people may think, okay, it is what it is, but they've actually made a donation. Prime spoke about it in his entry-level acceptance speech, that Colorado had made a silent donation to the state, Jackson State. I forgot the exact amount, but they actually have given back, and Prime said that really made him think about the offer, he said, because he pushed it. And he said, them people didn't have to do that because they were recruiting me. So for them to make a donation to the school that I was actually at, I mean, sometimes you got to realize people are going to invest in you. And a lot of times we're so naive and don't take on those opportunities because this culture that we all speak about, we all know that it's some, it's false to everything. But when you elevate, it's not that he's saying HBCUs aren't it. Maybe there are some things that need to be addressed. And again, back to Spirit's point, that's where the accountability comes in. And I don't think it's just from a school perspective. I think it's elected officials' perspective, a lot of different things. And I don't think he's going to stop speaking about it because now he doesn't have to deal with the ramifications of y'all trying to hinder him actually even building it more than you did in the 3 years because you wasn't expecting this type of success. So we may just need to be on the lookout to what else is exposed that may be addressed at a lot of different HBCUs that could impact them in a real way. And starting with why are they underpaid when other schools that have resources are paid more and it's really hard for them to even get on a charter flight to get to y'all to play and get their ass whooped and get injured and come back and try to compete against schools that are actually on their level. Let's just be real now. It's going to be some stuff that's being spoken about.
Some of them taking buses still, bro. Some of them still taking buses.
Yeah, that's what I'm, you know what I'm saying?
So kids taking 10, 12-hour, 15-hour bus rides to get to play some of these schools and then have to play the next day after sitting on a bus for 15 hours.
15 hours. Get their ass whooped, stiff as hell, need to be stretched out, everything. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah.
I don't see how people looking at this as he making it seem like HBCUs ain't the place to be. Because he showed put the spotlight on HBCUs, but he also put the spotlight on things that need to be fixed with HBCUs. But he made that the place to be because you got to remember, when he started coaching there, HBCU enrollments went up at all the schools just about all the schools increased enrollment. TSU, I think they had they best ever. I want to say if it wasn't the best ever, it increased to a point where it ain't been in a long time. To the point where the governor was pretty much saying like, what y'all doing over there? Why everybody want to go there and not go to these other schools?
But because of what you just said, it just brought something else to my mind. If he a sellout for leaving, what are we for not going? What are we for not enrolling at HBCUs knowing everything that's going on? What are we for not putting our dollars and our funds and our resources back into HBCUs if Deion's a sellout? What are we? What are we as a culture if Deion's a sellout? What are we then?
Because I hear somebody, just being around here, I hear somebody get celebrated more for going to UT Knox than going to TSU, than going to Alabama A&M, than going to Lane College, than going to Jackson State, you know what I'm saying? They're going to Texas Southern. If somebody be like, hey, man, he going to play for UT Vols, man, they having a party. They doing everything. Now, you know, they be like, oh, yeah, they going to TSU, going to have a little get-together at the house, cook a little something, but y'all go all out, they going to play for the Vols or something.
Yeah.
Then, you know, for our final thoughts, so we can actually wrap it up, we're going to touch bases on some other topics surrounding this. But to your point, like, yeah, because they go all out for them big Power Five schools and, you know, it's Roll Tide and Hook 'em Horns, et cetera. And then when they hear the kids say that they're going to the HBCU, man, you going to the hood to play? We condition our minds more than anything.
How many kids on Alabama roster should have probably been playing at HBCU?
Man, listen, we wouldn't even be talking about Alabama if majority of the athletes stayed in the hood and actually play the HBC. Like, it wouldn't even be a need for it because back in the day, it used to be a thing. Now it's not because they're accepting us. So I get where people will be coming from with that. And he said he was going to switch the tide. But just because he left doesn't mean that y'all don't stop recruiting.
Right.
Like, it's on you. Like, it really is on you. Like,
he left the blueprint.
That's just what that is.
He left the blueprint. He recorded the blueprint. If you call him, he probably going to tell you hey, this is what you need to do, X, Y, Z. I mean, it's out there.
And I'm
Eddie
still,
George.
And I'm still big on we should go to HBCUs. I'm still big on our athletes, our academics, our anybody black should go to HBCU. But I'm also logical and understanding enough to say, do what's best for you. So, right. If not going to HBCU is honestly what's best for you, do what's best for you. Right. I still think every black person, man, woman, or child should go experience HBCU life. I'm telling you, there's nothing like it. It's second to none. However, if somebody chooses not to, I mean, that's just the best choice that they thought was for them. And realistically, every black child, every black person is not going to coach, teach, or attend the HBCU. So we can't call everybody a sellout, because half of these Negroes that are talking all this noise didn't attend a HBCU. But he the sellout?
And I call out my hometown for sure, because well, none of them really talking about HBCUs. We had one down the street, and they didn't speak too highly of it at all. So that's why I didn't end up going to Lane College, because everybody was like, man, don't go there, man. It's terrible. Don't do that. Don't do that. But what about somewhere else? I heard this about TSU. Well, hold on now. Like, yeah, that's the next thing. Like, we can't be talking about these schools, and then here we are 20 years later when Deion leave, man. He wrong for that, blah, blah, blah. Hold on, when I was in high school, you that same person that wasn't talking too fun HBCUs. You want me to go to all these PWI schools, name what I was with.
Yeah. You know, when it's trendy, we all on board. But you know, you can go up there with the Moonshiners and UT Knox, and you didn't, you know, you done made it big. Like something can't happen to you there that unheard of, that'll be really unsolved. Like, right. You feel me? But you know. That's what it is, man. We're going to have to – there's another thing that has been looming we didn't really get to speak on, really get to dive into, so we'll definitely have to touch back on the Coach Prime effect is what we're going to call it, and get back into it. Flake, did you get a – you don't have a black business minute, right?
Oh, I got the Supreme Black Person of the Week.
I mean, spirit – damn.
Yeah, I'm going to go do that. I'm going to go do that and let y'all boys close, because you know me, cheerleader dad, so I got to get to this – to the cheerleading situation going on tonight. But yes. The our Supreme Black Person of the Week is going to be Jessica O. Matthews. She's a Nigerian-American inventor, founder, CEO, and venture capitalist. She's the co-founder of Uncharted, which made a socket, which is a soccer ball that can be used as a portable power generator. She attended Harvard College and graduated from Harvard Business School. She was named in 2011, named Fortune, named one of the most 10 most powerful women and entrepreneurs. And in 2015, they named her as most promising women entrepreneurs. Once again, she did attend Howard University. She is a Nigerian American. No, she did not attend the HBCU, but she's out here doing her thing and getting everything popping as a businesswoman. So shout out to Jessica O. Matthews. She is one of the most powerful black women in tech today.
And, I don't have a black business minute, but I do want to just shout out to this and just say this real quick. Kyrie was dropped from Nike officially today. And so I just want to say, let's make sure that we put as much support behind our black designers, our black creators, our black clothing lines and shoe companies or whatever that we do behind Nike, Reebok, Adidas or whatnot. Go ahead, Flake.
My understanding, his contract was about to be over with, and they was having issues before the other situation came up, especially when he went on social media and said the last shoe they made for him was trash, and they ain't even let him really pick out what he wanted to do on the shoe. Ever since he did that, they had some issues, so everybody kind of figured that contract was coming to an end.
Nah, I understand, but
not to excuse what you said, because we definitely do that regardless.
Nah, I understand, but when you are the second, outside of the Jordan brand, where you are the second biggest bringer in of money. I can't think of the proper word for that, but the bringer in of money in the Nike thing behind LeBron and the Nike conglomerate behind LeBron. Of course, we're excluding the Jordan brand because that's in a conglomerate of his own.
Yeah, that's on its own.
But it's LeBron, then Kyrie. Yep. When you bring in dollars like that, you need to make sure that you make concessions for me versus, right. Oh, I'm expendable when I'm bringing you in hundreds of million dollars a year. So again, my statement still remains the same, but I was privy to what you said and I was knowledgeable of that. So I knew all of that was going down as well.
Okay.
You could go ahead and close us out, Rose.
Yeah, well, everybody, I appreciate you all tapping in, man. We'll be dropping this episode soon. I thought Flake was going to at least do the drop, but it's all good. I appreciate you tapping in, man. If you're on YouTube, make sure you like, share, and subscribe. For our audio listeners, we're about to be getting back to pushing the content over there, man. Spirit, you got anything to close us out with?
Peace, love, and stop the hate. Let's support. Stop the hate.
There it is, man. As always, long live CC. I appreciate you tapping in with Supreme the Black Podcast. We out.
We out.